and the mechanism of injury and the contributing factors, which often we can sort of help and alleviate the problem. So later on, I'm going to use a sort of chronic ankle sprain as a good example of how sometimes something very, very simple, a lot of things will get missed. Now, I'm going to let you, you can look at the anatomy at your own leisure, but basically, if we're talking about any sort of pathologies, the majority of pathologies, especially when we're talking at the musculoskeletal level, the things that are going to be involved are the bones, joints, muscles and tendons, and nerves around said joint or area. For, in the case of the foot, this is a pretty complex instrument. This is a pretty complex thing. There's 26 bones, 30 joints, 100 muscles around it, or being supplied by tendons, and the bone is the foundation for a lot of attachments for these muscles and tendons, and the joints allow that the sort of movement and adaptation. We're not able to actually walk without the foot being able to move and mold to the ground, and also to turn around and become more rigid and give us a push off, and that's very, very important. There are a number of joints, and some are less important in an actual ankle sprain, but some of the less important ones can sometimes be involved and cause the actual ankle to be problematic, and then the muscle tissue to contract more or less, or a certain amount of instability, which is going to cause problems around the various joints, and that they can also cause pain. Pretty much the ankle joint's made up of a sort of tibio-talar joint, which is the tibia and the talus. The talonavicular joint a little bit more distal to that, and tarsometatarsal joint, or Lisfranc's joint, obviously the metatarsal phalangeal, which are more of the foot, and this subtalar joint, which is very important in the sort of inversion and eversion, so that we can move our foot and mold it accordingly. So if any of these are damaged, they can have a sort of knock-on effect, almost a domino effect, or they could have they could actually be causing pain themselves. So we need to consider those things when we're looking at the sort of structures and what may be causing the pain. It's very easy to say, okay, it's an ankle sprain, but an ankle sprain in itself could be like just a sprain around the sort of the lateral side, where the fibula sort of has its join through the anterior talar fibula ligament to the talus, and obviously a sprain there, but often other joints will be involved, and we'll look at that a little bit. I don't want to go too much into the anatomy, because obviously it's going to take a lot of time. There are very sort of important ligaments like the anterior talar fibula ligament, the ATFL, which I mentioned. Posterior talar fibula ligament kind of runs around the back. That will often be a problem sometimes, especially if you've got like a sort of os trigonum, where you've got this little bit of a bone that pushes into it, and calcaneal fibula ligament, the Achilles tendon, things like that, they can be involved. That's the lateral side. On the medial side, we're going to have the sort of deltoid ligament, which is made up of three ligaments: posterior tibio-talar, the tibio-calcaneal, the anterior tibio-talar ligament. The delta is a very thick ligament. It's kind of this sort of deltoid shape, and that doesn't sprain very easily. The only times I've really seen it badly injured was like football players, when somebody would go over the top of a football from the outside of their foot and just basically force their ankle sort of into stressing the medial side because of it, and then you could get a sprain. But it's not one that's easily sprained. There are other ligaments on medium side as well, or medial side, sorry, such as the sustentaculum tali and of the calcaneus, and the tibio and navicular ligament. So these can be quite important. So when you're looking at an ankle, you may be wanting to consider the lateral structures or the medial structures. The lateral structures can be ligaments or bone. It can also be tendons, or the medial structures, which could be ligaments and bone. bear in mind that if you have an inversion sprain, basically where the lateral part of the foot goes outwards, we'll look at that in a little bit more detail later on. But if you look at that, if you're going to strain on the lateral side, you're going to get compression on the medial side, and somebody will be complaining of pain, and that could mean it's either from the ligament, which has been strained on the lateral side, or it could be compression of the bone, and there's a cartilage between the joints or the ostium or things like that, where it gets a compression sort of force put through it, and that becomes very sore as well. So that, again, you need to consider the sort of structure, which structure and why it's causing the problem. Obviously, we've got muscles. They, for the sake of simplicity, they're divided into compartments, like the anterior compartment, the lateral compartment, the deep and superficial compartments. One nasty little thing that happens often occasionally with people is you get this sort of compartment syndrome where the muscles, as you can see in the sort of diagram, sort of press on the bone and the nerve and the blood vessels and actually cut off any sort of supply, and that causes sort of some neural problems. Obviously, again, we talk about the tendons. There's not much room around the foot for muscles to pass down. You've got some of the inside natural foot themselves, like the interossei, but the actual muscles tend to be further up the tibia towards the knee. And so their supply or their action on certain leverage comes via various tendons, whether it's the peroneal tendons or the tibial anterior tendons, the extensor digitorum tendons, the extensor tendons like for hallucis, which is the big toe. And they will pass up underneath retinaculum where they're sort of held in to stop them kind of bowstringing and popping about. And and they can become sprained. Now, one of the problems is that if you get an ankle sprain and it's a long term, often one or more of these tendons may be working overtime to kind of stabilize the foot because there's not enough or not optimum proprioception. Medial side is exactly the same, but the thing is, on the medial side, because you get flexor hallucis and flexor digitorum running down underneath the medial malleolus with this sort of big strip of retinaculum sitting over the top of it. In between them is the tibial nerve and some blood vessels as well. They can become inflamed, and then you get the good old tarsal tunnel syndrome, which is similar to the carpal tunnel syndrome that we get in the wrist. It's basically a nerve, two tendons, and it just becomes inflamed and everything gets crushed up and it becomes quite painful. And sometimes that can be misdiagnosed as being part of a problem with an ankle sprain. A similar thing happened, not as exactly the same, but a similar sort of things happen on the lateral side. When we talk of the nerves of the ankle, they're very, very important, because I've just mentioned the tibial nerve can be a sort of cause of tarsal tunnel syndrome. But one of the big things that can be very problematic is the superficial peroneal nerve. If you look at this picture, it is basically running across the top of the anterior talar fibular ligament. And there's a little sign there that says, I don't know if I can show this easily, but with the mouse. But you can see this red sort of dot here. It's running across the anterior talar fibular ligament. And you can actually see it. It's really, really superficial. In some people, it's just like a wire. You can actually ping it. And obviously, if that's been affected in an ankle sprain, it can be quite painful. And it's relevant in the case study we're going to be talking about. I don't want to give too much away. So ankle sprain pathophysiology. Well, it can be a partial or complete tear of one or more of the ligaments surrounding the ankle joint. There are obviously the common ones like the anterior talar fibular ligament. The clinical presentation, for example, on the lateral side, will be after an inversion injury or a forceful eversion injury. Again, I said that the eversion injury, where the sort of foot goes outwards, would put strain on the deltoid ligament. Because it's such a big ligament, it has to be an awful lot of strain. Now, a soccer player coming through at sort of 35 miles an hour over the top of a ball and hitting you on the lateral side of your ankle, that's a pretty good strain. But that's the kind of thing you really, really need. The only other times it happens is you get a lot of wear and tear, and then sometimes it just breaks as a result of that. I've seen that maybe once in 30 years as my career. Often sort of previous history of ankle injury will be one of the components that will cause instability and then further problems. And the biomechanics of the foot, which is where we come onto the contributing factors. Remember, we talked about structure, cause, mechanism of pain, and the contributing factors. Well, people that have these sort of very rigid, high arch foot, they're prone to ankle sprains, because as their foot hits the ground in a sort of supinated position, the ground reaction force spins them over, and then they come spinning back, and that can be a precursor to ankle sprains. So it's worth sometimes looking at that and considering the various parts that are involved in that. They'll come in, they'll be obviously not weight-bearing on the side that they've twisted or sprained. They will sometimes talk about sort of paresthesia or this sort of numbness or whatever. It could indicate the nerve damage. Depending how early or how late, tenderness, swelling, bruising, they can occur on either side of the ankle. There can be bony tenderness, as I said, on the side that became compressed, but it's not usual, and there's not usually a deformity or sort of crepitus that's present. But they might be positive when you sort of do a sort of passive inversion or in eversion, especially in the earlier parts of a grade one sort of sprain. Anything above that is obviously going to be painful for other reasons. Inversion and plantar flexion will often replicate the symptoms of a lateral sprain. Eversion may well exacerbate or produce the symptoms of a medial ligament sprain. There are special tests that we can do, and they're not always very effective early on in the sprain. Somebody gets it in the middle of the foot. If you first get to feel what's going on, you may elicit some sort of, with the anterior draw, the talar tilt, you may elicit pain or some instability. And there's also the differential diagnosis, such as the Ottawa scale or the Ottawa ankle rules, which is quite sensitive, almost 100%. And it's said that the sort of a patient who presents with none of the symptoms is less likely to have a fracture, or less like 1% less likely to have a fracture. And it should reduce the number of unnecessary sort of radiological examination. Basically, the sort of rules are that if there's a bony tenderness along the sort of distal 6 centimeters of the edge of the fibula or the lateral malleolus, or the same for the medial malleolus, or if there's a bony tenderness at the base of the fifth metatarsal or the navicular, and an inability to bear weight, both immediately after the injury and four steps after the initial evaluation. If those sort of rules are coming up, this sort of tenderness on these bones and this inability to walk, there's a chance of maybe a fracture, and then you want to go on and have it x-rayed and looked at to clear that. But otherwise, it could just be a sprain. So you only really need an ankle sprain if there is pain in the malleolar zone, as I said, on those sort of distal 6 centimeters medial or laterally, and the inability to bear weight. You should, if you've got sort of pain in the middle of the foot, and again, this sort of bony tenderness around the fifth metatarsal, because it could be an avulsion fracture, and they are quite common actually, and often missed, where basically the peroneal tendon pulls off the bony point of the fifth metatarsal. Again, bony tenderness and a navicular, which is pretty hard to damage because it's sort of in the center of a lot of other bones. So if you're getting sort of signs there, then maybe get an ankle x-ray carried out, because it's quite important. Now, the ankle sprains, as we said, we can have the anterior talar fibular ligament, which is the most commonly damaged. That's the sort of inversion sprain. And the deltoid ligament, very strong because it consists of a number of ligaments much less likely to be sprained. We can also have a syndesmosis sprain, which is pretty nasty, which is basically where the leg or the foot is kind of externally rotated and around the tibia and the fibula at the same time as there's a dorsiflexion of the foot. And it involves a damage to the interosseous membrane. So when we're looking at the structure cause mechanism of pain and contributing factors, well, certainly the structure you could be considering when we spoke about arthrogenic, is it a joint type of problem, or is it a myogenic, a tendon or muscular problem? But when there's a bit more, I say discogenic, that could be sort of applied to the interosseous membrane. Also, there are anterior, inferior, and posterior, inferior, transverse ligaments that get damaged. Sometimes in these rare cases, it's either happened before, it could be a result of a sprain, particularly if somebody's really plantar flexed. You get this osteotrigonum. Some people are developed like this little chunk of bone on a calcaneus, and that breaks off or actually goes right into the ligaments and becomes quite painful. Basically, plantar flexing somebody and pushing it, the calcaneus in, can exacerbate the pain. And that's a nice sort of picture of the sort of inversion sprain on the left hand side. Again, I hope my mouse is going to show you this. This is the damage to the anterior talar fibular ligament. The foot's been turned inwards, the foot being turned outwards for the inversion sprain. The high ankle sprain, again, when I was talking about, was the sort of tibia and leg kind of rotate inward, and then you get this sort of straining here and of the lower ligaments, and it can tear the lower ligaments because of it. So that's a lot rarer, but also a lot more problematic. We can classify ankle sprains in various ways, so like a normal, a grade one sprain. It's kind of stretching and small tears. A grade two is a larger, but it's an incomplete. And grade three is a complete tear, and that's an operation, basically to get it fixed. And then somebody's put in a cast for quite a long time. If somebody's coming into a clinic, it probably will be after they've been treated for that. It's usually quite obvious. So you have this microscopic sort of injury for grade one, a more macroscopic stretching, but the ligament intact for grade two, and a rupture of the ligament for grade three. It was usually covered used to cover one ligament, but it may not be suitable if more than one ligament is damaged. But how it's going to be treated can vary. Another system is the sort of three-graded classification based on the severity of the sprain and how it looks. Like if there's a little bit of swelling and tenderness with little impact on function, it could be a grade one. It makes sense, really, if you're looking at it from how our ligament is damaged, because a grade one, if it's only a small amount of damage, and it's only going to have a little bit of swelling and tenderness usually, and it's not going to have a major impact on function. That's going to be more one of those ones where people just sort of kind of go over on their ankle and hurt it. A grade two is usually a little bit more forceful, quite a lot of swelling, moderate swelling, quite a lot of impact on function. There'll be reduced proprioception, range of movement, and instability because you've got quite a nasty tear there that the ankle is actually flopping around. And a complete rupture will obviously is going to be a lot of everything, and there is going to be marked instability. So basically any test you do, and people do sometimes manage it, because remember there are a number of ligaments around it. Sometimes they can manage and turn up with a grade three of just one ligament. And then you kind of pull the foot and it sort of goes blip like that. And you sort of think, oh, that doesn't seem right. And so you would need to get that investigated more, because it may have an effect on how you're going to treat. You wouldn't be able to get too far with it without maybe an operation. Sometimes you can, but again, structure, cause, mechanism of injury. I've not really spoken much about the mechanism of injury, because it's going to tend to be, for an ankle sprain, more of a sort of nociceptive inflammatory, but there may be other elements involved in it. So for the case of this case study, and for the sake of simplicity, we're going to sort of use a case study of an ankle sprain about 6 months post-injury rather than industry, to illustrate the sort of structure, cause, mechanism, and contributing factors, the SCMC method of looking at. But you should only work within your scope of practice, because some of the techniques you might be able to use to test it or to treat it, you may not be allowed to do it depending on your licensing, or you may not really know how to do it. One part of it could be neural dynamics. You need to be careful with that. It can be very dangerous and sometimes very uncomfortable. Again, I'm not going to try and reinvent the wheel. A lot of people would be doing these tests. It's just to make you look at it maybe from a little bit of a more in-depth way, so you don't miss certain things. So in the case of this ankle sprain, it's a 28-year-old male. He's got deep pain on the lateral ankle with his right sort of foot. It's been bothering him for nearly 6 months. Sometimes it's a dull ache, sometimes it's burning, and sometimes it's stinging. The visual analog scale, the pain scale that we use just as an easy one when we're assessing, is about 5 out of 10, which isn't enormously painful. It can be all day, it can be worse in the evening, and sometimes it'll even get the pain lying in bed. But it comes and goes, it's an intermittent sort of pain. It's often aggravated by walking in tight shoes. And if he plays football for an hour or so, now remember, this is 6 months down the line, he's back to sport, it can start aching and being uncomfortable. But he tightens his shoes up and it gets even worse after a while. And then if he pushes over the ankle or and around the inside of the foot, it also kind of aggravates it. But it relieves it if he puts his foot up, moves his foot around, bends his knee, takes his shoes off for 10 to 15 minutes. Sometimes the relief takes a little bit longer. This is the guy that's come in basically complaining of this. So he was in the middle of a game. It was a two-footed tackle, and it actually led to an inversion sprain and a contusion on the lateral aspect of the ankle. He stopped playing immediately. There was quite a lot of pain. He couldn't really move. There was swelling and bruising. And he did the usual price, the sort of resting it, icing it, compression, elevating it, and preventing any other problems. And he got a lot of advice from friends. There's quite a lot of that when you're in sports rooms. But the problem is now, the present condition, is it's still painful as above, not as painful, but he has full range of movement and some pain at the end of the range of movement, such as inversion. He hasn't had any recurrent sprains, but it feels weak when he's running. And a sort of pain is exacerbated around the malleolus when he presses on it, particularly the lateral malleolus. And it's annoying. It just doesn't seem to go, and it's bugging him because he's had it for 6 months. He had no history of ankle sprains. It's not something that was bothering him for a long time. And he's had treatment for including physiotherapy, ultrasound, and after a period he was in an air cast. His general health is completely healthy. He's taken sort of NSAIDs, these non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like Nurofen, things like that. They help temporarily, and he doesn't feel pain when he's been drinking beer quite a lot, shall we say. So that stops the pain occasionally, isn't being able to alcohol. In his investigations, and because it wasn't a problematic, he didn't have an X-ray, but he did undergo an ultrasound a bit later because of the assessment, and it basically showed a lot of swelling and a small tear around the anterior talar fibular ligament. He's married, he works in a factory, and he's basically his hobby is playing football with his friends at the weekend, or soccer with his friends at the weekend. So looking at that, I'm going to try and consider how I'm going to do my objective plan. I don't want to do things that are going to exacerbate them too much. I want to get as much information as I can out of it. So I'm going to consider what structures were involved. So I'm already thinking and considering the arthrogenic area, the joint aspect of the problem, the inversion sprain around the talocrural joint, the damage to the ligaments would indicate maybe something joint, the pain, lack of movements, and swelling and bruising also fit in with that, an inversion sprain and a contusion on the lack of on the lateral aspect of ankle again. So it makes me think maybe there's a joint aspect to it. Why were they? Because basically he underwent an ultrasound, and that sort of showed sort of a swelling and a small tear on the ATFL. So again, that gives me an idea that maybe there's a joint involvement. With regards to muscle and tendon, there could have been some damage because of the sprain. It could have been some damage because of the problem after the sprain, and then the tendons become inflamed. There's sort of an inflammatory nature simply because as he's taking NSAIDs, they're helping him, but it also feels weak when he's running. So that kind of gives an indication that maybe there's something muscular or tendinous going on there. I'm also thinking there may be a nerve there. Well, I know there's a nerve there, but I maybe think there may be some neural aspect to it. Why? Because the superficial peroneal nerve lies directly over the anterior talar fibula ligament. It's often damaged in inversion, and that I can just tell you, and people don't really give it the credit it deserves for causing pain. It's a long-term sort of pain that this guy's got, even after he's been healing. It's annoying. It doesn't seem to go. The pain decreases when he drinks alcohol, and that could be an element of neural involvement. He's undergone an ultrasound. Like I said, there's been swelling that shows around the ATFL. That could be sort of washing the superficial peroneal nerve with this inflammatory exudate, and that will really irritate the nerve. So then we've already started looking at what structures. Is there an osteogenic element? The foot was forced into inversion. So on the opposite side, you're going to get a sort of bone is going to be compressed, and ligaments on the ipsilateral side are going to pull on the periosteum. So sort of pain around the lateral malleolus. And I may not be explaining this properly, but if you think of the foot as it goes into inversion like this, on the medial side it's going to get compressed. And there might be pain around the medial sort of malleolus as you press it. Obviously, you've strained on the ipsilateral side, the ligaments, that's the ATFL. But on the medial side, the opposite side, you've got compression of the bony structures, and that's kind of showing up as well. There's obviously some sort of psychological yellow flags, the advice he's getting. He's had a diagnosis of a tear from the ultrasound. It doesn't necessarily mean that that's the big problem. A tear can heal and not be that big a problem. But I don't think there's any discogenic, fascia, vascular or visceral problems. So I can rule them off. And that will help me decide how I'm going to do my objective assessment. The severity I got from them, well, it's not very severe. It's only 5 out of 10 on the VAS. But it's pretty low irritability as well. 1 hour to sort of start bothering, 10 to 15 minutes to relieve. It's not something that's carrying on for days. So it means I can maybe be a little bit more aggressive or be a bit more involved in how I test the structures. It's an intermittent lancinating sort of pain. Again, that's making me think, oh, maybe there's a sort of nerve problem there. It's sore to touch, it's shooting. The stability is not worsening, but it's still annoying. And there aren't any sort of contraindications or special precautions from the subjective examination that I've done. So I'm thinking it's a kind of inflammatory element because of the response to non-steroidals. There's definitely a mechanical element because there's pain on certain elements. I don't think there's an ischemic problem. Somatic referred pain, well, there's no sort of indication that pain is being referred from other structures. Peripheral neurogenic, as I said, yes, there's this deep dirt burning pain that starts, particularly when he's wearing shoes. Now, when I worked in the for various military or consultancy I was doing, a lot of soldiers would come in, often sort of infantry soldiers. One of the things they tend to get is either knee pain or ankle sprains because they keep rolling over on rocks. And often what they would do is they would tighten their boots up, hoping that it would sort of give them some sort of stability. The reason army boots are so high is basically to stop stones falling into the shoe so they can carry on running. It's not there to give you support. In actual fact, the bit that they try and tighten up gives very little support. And they'll be tightening the shoelaces up. And basically all they were doing was making the boot fold and press over the top of the anterior talar fibula ligament and the superficial peroneal nerve, which was just irritating it and making it more irritable. And this guy has been saying where he wears tight shoes or boots, it's painful, and it's not responding to treatment for the sort of treatment he's been having for maybe the ligament. So that would also indicate possibly a neural element. I don't think there's any central signs. There's no sort of unusual pains there, no autonomic sort of pains, changes in colour or things like that. The main effective element is the information he's got and the results from the ultrasound. And contributing factors are the type of shoes and boots he's wearing, possibly his training regime and the surfaces that he's working on. So now I go into my objective assessment. As I said before, how I like to do it, and there is some debate as to which sequence you do this. You should, first of all, we should always compare the injured side to the opposite side. It's usually better to carry out the assessment on the good side first, or the less affected side first, and then the affected side afterwards, because you don't want to set up any sort of pain mechanisms. Basically, what I do is I take away the level of control the client or patient has. So I look at the foot, I look for swelling, I look for deformities, I look for any sort of possible biomechanical contributing factors like a high arch and supinated foot. That's, the patient has all the control over that. I can't do anything about that. I don't take any control off of him. With active range of movement, when I'm getting him to go through the inversion, eversion, plantar flexion, dorsiflexion, I'm taking a little bit of control away simply because I'm telling him to do something he may not want to do, but it's nothing really a bigger deal. Resisted range of movement is a similar sort of thing, except I'm now putting my hands on him more to possibly cause some sort of symptom or some sort of result as a result of my resistance. So again, he still has control, but I'm taking a little bit away because I'm actually causing something to happen. And then the passive range of movement, well, basically I'm asking the patient to relax, and I want to feel everything that's going on there. So I have quite a lot of control there, as again with the special tests. Now, when I was in physiotherapy school, I spent hours, and my students still do, learning all these special tests, whether it was in sort of anterior tilt or squeeze test or things like that. Any special test only gives you a certain amount of information, and it often involves a number of structures, not just the one that you are trying to elicit some sort of symptoms from. So really, it's only like the peak of the triangle, and it's only should be used in conjunction with everything else that we're doing. So let's just say for the case study, there's sort of no sort of obvious deformities, toes, leg length, internal, external rotation. I could be looking at standing and walking symmetry, muscle bulk and the sort of, if it's shortened, I would get them to do functional tests like a squat, one leg standing, hopping, overpronation when they're walking, and a certain amount of swelling. You can look at the sort of asymmetries from the front, the side and the back, leg length discrepancies. And again, these are like the contributing factors part of it. Is there a supination, pronation of the foot? Again, remember, said that a supinated foot can be prone to ankle sprains. Sort of the squatting can examine the sort of hips, knees and ankles, get them to lunge, hopping, walking, one leg standing. These will give an idea of the proprioception through all their movements and a sort of any swelling or change of colour around the area. I will get them to do various active ranges of movement like dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. That's the talar crural joint, the subtalar joint, inversion and eversion, flexion and extension of the sort of toes. Stress the effect would be better than stress, the metatarsal interphalangeal joints. And I would always consider during movement the quality of movement, the range of movement, the amount of control a patient has over it. Is any sort of muscle spasm or pain behavior? And I can alter these tests. Now, I can do that both for my passive, my resisted, and my active range of movement. I could alter the speed with which I carry out the movement. I can repeat the movements. I can repeat the movements at different speeds. I can combine movements. I can do a sustained movement. I can compress or distract the joint as I'm doing the movement. These are things that if something isn't sort of been presented with the initial movement that I can add in to try and give myself more information, sort of they're doing it faster, I'm repeating it more often, or I'm doing it with some sort of compression may give me a little bit more information about what's going on and where. As I said, there's an argument as to whether you should resist before the passive range of movement or after. I tend to prefer to reduce the amount of control the patient has, but I do my resisted movement sort of before the passive ranges of movement. You carry out the resisted movement through range rather than just doing an isometric, but you can also do an isometric test at different points in the range, but it's worth carrying it out through different points in the range. I will look to see sort of how the patient's reacting. Is he guarding the pain? Is there lack of control of the area? It could be neurological. What sort of quality of the contraction? Does it feel like it's normal, or does it just feel like really sort of weak and not the way it should be? And then I'll compare this to the sort of passive range of movement, because that will give me a good idea of whether there's a contractile element or non-contractile structures which are involved. Then I will go on to the special tests. I can either palpate, I can do neural differentiation or accessory tests. Remember, all tests will stress probably more than one structure. Be aware of that. You do a neural test, you're likely to be stressing tendons, and you may need to do some sort of differentiation between that. The accessory movements can include sort of glides and compressions and distractions. A glide and compression may exacerbate the pain. A distraction will often relieve it. They should be carried out in conjunction with the ligament stress tests, such as draw test, tilt test, and end of range passive movement tests. I don't tend to do end of range unless, for example, if I'm testing somebody and say, oh, it hurts, and it's at the beginning, I'm not going to do an overpressure just for the sake of it, which is basically taking the joint to its fullest extent and then pushing a bit more, because I'm already elicited the pain, isn't it? I'm not going to gain any more from it. Other than if I want to see how much instability, but that could be looking at some of the other stress tests that I could be looking at. As I said, joint integrity tests such as the anterior draw sign, a tailored tilt, subtailored glides and compressions. Again, it'll give me an idea of stability, what's happening at certain points in the range of the joint rather than tendons or neural structures. Then I will palpate, I will look at the temperature, if there's any sort of sweating, edema, how the superficial tissues moving, like through skin rolling, the mobility of the superficial tissues. I could be looking for trigger points in certain muscle structures or muscle tissue, and tendon is over the bone or the ligaments or the tendon or the muscle or the nerve itself. One test that is very useful in ankle sprains, especially chronic ones, there's neural dynamic tests. But you should only do it if you know what you're doing. There isn't sort of any room for the cavalier attitude, as somebody once said. And because if you set off the pain because of the nerve becoming really, really irritated, then it's not a good thing. But you can sort of palpate the nerve. Now, often the nerve will be sensitive along its course, so the problem may be at the area of the anterior talar fibular ligament of the superficial peroneal nerve, but if it's been going for a long time, it could be actually quite painful along its course, and you find areas like around the head of the fibula or over the piriformis or the bifurcation of the sciatic nerve or even the deep peroneal nerve between the first and second metatarsals. They can flare up and be quite uncomfortable compared to the other side. Obviously, you have to compare it to the other side. The sural nerve around behind the lateral malleolus and the tibial nerve behind the medial malleolus, they're not necessarily going to be painful, but they may be worth considering. I can test these by doing a straight leg raise. Now, a straight leg raise, I can just lift the leg up, or I can then put the leg into the foot into dorsiflexion, and that will tension the sciatic nerve right the way down. But again, these have a great deal of potential to cause latent pain, and so you should need to be careful. And also you need to be careful where you're putting your hands. You know, if you're gripping the base of the calcaneus and your hands are hooked onto the medial nerve, you're going to get a false positive, because they're going to say, or the tibial nerve, sorry, not the median nerve, the tibial nerve, they're going to say, oh, that hurts. And it could be a little bit sensitive, but it's not the nerve that's causing problem. But if one wants to test, say, for example, a superficial peroneal nerve, then plantar flexion and inversion, basically you would put that on and take the leg into a straight leg raise, and they will say, oh, that hurts. And then you could bend the knee and they say the pain goes off. It's pretty likely only going to be a nerve rather than tendons, because you've just released the pain from the knee and none of the tendons and the muscles are going above it. Same with the tibial nerve. You could take them into sort of dorsiflexion and eversion, and then do a straight leg raise, and they will say, oh, it's painful on the inside, you bend the knee, it goes off. It's a sign that maybe the tibial nerve is involved. The sural nerve would be dorsiflexion and inversion. By doing those and then maybe palpating along the course of the nerve all the way up to the spine, and even around the spine, around the lumbar spine, you could get an idea that maybe neural structures are involved, and it's quite useful. So at the end of my objective test, I should have a good idea, and it should support my original subjective hypothesis, and it will provide me with many of the sort of contributing factors involved in the dysfunction. The active range of movement will tell me where the dysfunction is usually and what structures are involved. Resisted movement will let me know sort of if contractile structures are involved, or could it be muscle and tendon. The passive range of movement segment will highlight the non-contractile structures such as ligaments and give me a sort of idea, because of the contractile structures, whether they're working in an opposite way. The ligaments will react to tension, the bone will react to compression. Special tests will assist in this diagnosis, but again, it's the point of the triangle. It puts things under stress, but it gives me an idea, and they're only a small part of that, the whole picture. So in a case study, there were no obvious deformities, biomechanical or pathological. Slight limp with decreased weight bearing during the stance phase. That kind of indicates a sort of joint and ligament, possible tendon involvement, because he doesn't like to bear weight on it. There could be something moving around there, instability. There's some increased tone around the gastrocnemius and the peroneal muscles, indicating possible trigger points. Again, this is the case study. This is not what you'd be looking at generally. This is the case study in this particular case. Decreased proprioception, in other words, he's wobbling around. When he stands on one leg in hopping and jumping, he just cannot do it. So that would indicate mechanical pain and mechanoreceptor damage. We know what's going on. That could be due to instability. It could be due to the tendons and muscles or whatever not working the way they should be. There's no obvious overpronation or supination of the foot, which might indicate a possible recurrent sprains due to the ground reaction force. There's none of that, so I'm not worried about that. But there is a slight pocket of swelling over the anterior talar fibula ligament, and that was also in the ultrasound, which may indicate this sort of superficial peroneal nerve becoming sensitized by inflammatory exudate. So from the case study, the active range of movement segment, full active range of movement with pain, slight guarding at the end of range. Again, this is the case study. This guy's got full range of movement, but the pain and slight guarding of pain because of the pain at the end of range of inversion, combined inversion and plantar flexion. The patient indicates a sort of discomfort on the lateral side. So this indicates obviously a lateral ankle joint involvement, but there's not too much in the way of laxity. Resisted movement. There's no pain over the tendons or muscle belly during the contraction, either medial or lateral. Again, this is the case study. It suggests that contractile structures are less involved, but I might still need to consider the palpation of muscle tissue to give me an idea if there are trigger points, because often there will be trigger points, even if they're not the primary cause. The passive range of movement segment, there's lateral pain at the end of range, inversion and plantar flexion, combined inversion and plantar flexion, and pain increases laterally with overpressure, and contraction into inversion proved negative. So it could indicate sort of ligamentous structures, but no sort of laxity. Pain is sort of medially over the subtalar joint on the passive inversion with overpressure. So this is on the other side. And the special test is negative in all direction, but there's a little bit of pain on the subtalar joint with compression to a medial bias. So again, I'm taking the foot into sort of what would be inversion, and it would be on the medial side. So that would indicate some sort of compression of the bony structures of the ostium, or the periosteum, should I say, of the, may possibly the subtalar joint. The palpation again for this case study, no edema, no changes in temperature. There is temperature tenderness over the ATFL and the subtalar joint, both sides of the foot. Trigger points in the lateral and posterior compartment muscles, and slight restriction in movement of the soft tissue over the anterior talar fibula ligament. The nerve, the superficial peroneal nerve, is positive, and the common peroneal and sciatic nerve is sensitive along its distribution up to the lumbar spine, and it's neurally sensitive with a straight leg raise with plantar flexion and inversion, which is released with a knee bend and a modified slump. So basically what we did was we got the guy into a slump because I just wanted to check a little bit more. I basically slumped him with a straight leg raise and the inversion and plantar flexion. And I got them to lift their head up and straighten their spine, which has absolutely no connection from any muscles whatsoever, any ligaments, any tendons, and his pain went away. So that gives me an idea that that was a positive neural sort of dynamic element that's involved. And so therefore my objective assessment supported my subjective assessment. There's an arthrogenic element at the lateral talar crural joint, the ATFL strain, which is chronic. At the subtalar joint, there's a compression of the periosteum, but there's no laxity. Myogenic element, well, there are some trigger points and lateral and posterior muscles. That's not unusual in any sort of damage. The trigger points tend to flare up. They're often missed. There's an osteogenic element because of the sort of subjective counter irritation. I pushed on the subtalar joint, and an objective compression of the subtalar joint on the medial side is painful. There's also a neurogenic element, this sort of nerve pain, because there's pain along the distribution of the sciatic nerve. The common peroneal and specifically the superficial peroneal nerves are very sensitized, especially on the modified SLR. Or straight leg raise, where I've inverted the foot with plantar flexion and released it as a desensitizing maneuver at the knee. The palpation, there's no changes in temperature or edema. There is tenderness, as I said, over those two areas, the ATFL and the subtalar joint, and slight restriction in movement. So when we're looking at those things, comparing those along with the severity, which is low, the irritability, which is low, again, 5 out of 10, and then 10 to 15 minutes to relief. The nature of the pain is lancinating, sore to touch, shooting sort of pain. Stability is the same, it's not worsening, and there's no contraindications. I can then look at the pain mechanism. So I've looked at structures. I've looked at what's causing them. I now look at what sort of pain mechanism is involved. It's inflammatory, yes, it responds to non-steroidals. Mechanical, yes, because of certain movements. Ischemic, no. Somatic, no. Peripheral neurogenic, yes, because of this deep burning pain, wearing tight boots. He hasn't responded to treatment recently. He's not irritable, and it's positive on the sort of neural tests, neurodynamic tests, not neural tests like the tests that you would carry out to check the sort of conduction element, such as reflexes or myotomes and dermatomes. No central, no autonomic. The yellow flags we spoke about, there's some sort of belief and diagnosis because of the tests he's had done and what people are saying to him. And again, the type of shoes he's wearing and the way he trains, it could be involved. Now, this algorithm here, when looking at these things, okay, we've said arthrogenic, myogenic, no discogenic, possibly on osteogenic, excuse me, and neurogenic. That will then move me on to the sins, the severity, irritability, nature, and stability. Are there red flags? Are there intracontinental indications, precautions? The mechanism of pain and the sort of contributing factors such as sort of psychological or structural or a pathology, biomechanical. Look at the timeline as well. It's 6 months down the line, so it's fairly chronic. This will then lead me into what sort of treatments I can do. I can look at using manual therapy, such as massage, trigger point treatments, mobilization joints, manipulating joints. I'm not talking about the case study. This is more general now. I need to do visceral fascial releases, specific soft tissue movements, actually moving the tendon and kind of re-inflaming it, not deep frictions necessarily, but putting it through a sequence of events that will stress the soft tissues. Then I can also utilize exercise. I might want to stabilize the ankle. There's a lot of problem in this guy's case with the proprioception. So I may use stabilizing exercises, strengthening, or I may use exercises that mobilize the joints around it that may have become a bit stiff. I may want to stretch certain structures, and that may help with trigger points, although often it doesn't. I will use proprioceptive exercises. And then I could go on, depending on how high a sort of sportsman or what they want to use, the affected area for with aerobic and endurance and sort of and maybe even muscle imbalance and muscle energy techniques. And again, according to the licensing, what we're allowed to use, various modalities for electrotherapy, dry needling, that more fits in with the manual techniques and the way I think about it. But things like pain relief, such as using TENS or interferential, or inflammation, like using shortwave diathermy or pulse shortwave, there may be a use for acupuncture. We can fit all these different tools that we have and we've learned into our treatment regime. So I've gone through, I'm going backwards here. So basically, I have all the treatment, the information I need, and I can highlight my treatment plan. I've decided to. Sorry, I'm bouncing around here a little bit. I'm just want to make sure. We've spoken about some of these sort of areas, and I've done copies of this twice and that. So we've spoken about this particular patient, and so now I want to decide how I'm going to create my treatment plan. So I'm going to list my treatment plan. I'm going to make a justification for each treatment. I'm going to make the goals for each treatment. I'm going to use the results of the post-treatment to plan my next treatment. And then I will plan my next treatment, and I can record that using my SOAP notes. So he's got a low severity. We know we can sort of kind of get things moving. We can push forward with the treatment. We can use distraction techniques of the subtalar joint or even the talar crawl joint. There's no stiffness or things like that, so we don't really need to mobilize it or manip it, but we can use distraction techniques for pain. That can be quite nice. There's not too much laxity, but there is a decreased proprioception, so exercise would be relevant for the stability of the joint using proprioceptive exercises. And I may use electrotherapy for sort of pain relief, maybe put TENS actually over the various parts of the superficial peroneal nerve. I could treat the trigger points in the muscle tissue around it. That will also have an effect. I can use that. Don't use deep stroking, inhibition compression techniques, or dry needling to use that, or even muscle energy techniques. For the bone, again, this distraction may help it, so that might ease the sort of osteogenic component. And I could sometimes unload the areas using kinesiotape. And then we come on to the neurogenic pain. Now, I can use various techniques for that. I could use electrotherapy to calm it down with TENS, or I can actually try and unload the nerve around certain points, either at the point of the ATFL or even at the head of the fibula. And that could sort of unload the area. And I can also use the actual tests I did to just mobilize the neural structures, or maybe they may have become tethered, or just to get a sort of axoplasm to flow and sort of change how things are working along the nerve itself. So this is something I could use for a case study for a chronic ankle sprain. Some guys walked in, an ankle sprain he had some time ago. It's not getting better. The initial part did, but he's still sort of showing up with this sort of various problems. They come from various structures, part of its joint bone, part of its trigger points in the muscle, part of its the osteogenic compression point of the opposite side, and then a neurogenic element, which is often missed. And by treating all of those areas, the ankle sprain, which is the diagnosis, is going to be more effectively treated. I hope you've enjoyed this. I hope it wasn't too much and it's coming useful for you. Remember that we have various courses with NAT, which come with a lifetime access. And I hope you enjoyed it and look forward to seeing you again at some point.
That was fantastic, Paul. Thank you very much. So we do have our first question coming in, if you're ready for it. Do you need a sip of water or anything, or are you good to go, Paul?
Yeah, I'll just have a drink of Coke to help my diabetes and bring my sugar back up.
Give you some energy. So we have Jack here. Thank you, Jack, asking if the pain decreases after doing distraction at the ankle, could there be a bony involvement?
Yeah, pretty much. That's what I said. In the case of this chap, and it's something, a reason I use this, and we spoke about it in the last session, the reason I use this is quite simply is a good example, because it's one of those things that you see them quite a lot in a clinic, and then things are missed. If you've got a bony joint, for example, compression on the medial side, it's usually going to be compression around the subtalar joint. So by distracting that and the pain goes off, then fairly clearly is some sort of bony element in it. And you can use that as a treatment, because by doing that a few times, you kind of unload it and get sort of some sort of change in what's going on around that actual joint. So yes, a distraction both as a treatment and as a diagnostic test can be quite useful, and would indicate sort of some osteogenic element. I hope that answers the question.
Well, yeah, Jack, I hope that answers your question. Please, if there's a follow-up, please, you can enter it into the chat. Any of the other participants today, attendees, please, this is the moment to type in your questions. Feel free to do so now. In the meantime, Paul, any final notes, key takeaways before we wrap this up?
Well, I think basically what I've said in the beginning and constantly through, I'm not trying to sort of reinvent the wheel. This is basically everybody does an assessment to some extent, but sometimes we tend to look at things more as a pathology based or even mechanical based type of diagnosis. And sometimes just looking at each structure or considering each structure that's involved in this bigger picture gives us a much better chance of helping and treating our patients. And that was why I used the ankle sprain, because I've seen a lot of ankle sprains coming in from very, very acute, especially when I was working with the army, especially when I was working in soccer in Crystal Palace. And the patient would be really, really struggling with it and couldn't understand why it was giving him such a problem. And then eventually we would be treating it and looking at which structures were involved. Always consider the structures. Why are they bothering the patient? What the mechanism of pain is? And then the contributing factors. Look at those things and then how we can treat them, how we can alleviate them, how we can minimize them. What treatments we can use. Can we use a manual sort of technique? There's hundreds of manual techniques. There are lots and lots of millions of exercises, as you well know. And there are lots of sort of electrotherapy and other type of modalities, but you need to fit those to the problem. If you've got somebody with a neural problem, or a, for example, somebody comes in and they've got a, an inflamed ankle, but there's a neural element to it, and you want to do electrotherapy, you may need to look at treating the inflammatory element with electrotherapy, but also the pain element with electrotherapy. Equally, if you've got a somebody with a very stiff joint at certain points in the foot that could be affecting the ankle further up the kinematic chain, by mobilizing that joint and then stabilizing the bit that's flopping around a little bit or is less stable, you're going to have a better effect. It's the equal sort of thing with the manual techniques that we use. So consider the structures, why they're causing the problems, what the pain mechanism is, and then decide on your treatments accordingly.
So Jack was happy with your first response, just so you know. Thank you, Jack. And that concludes our 1 hour here with you. So, Paul, thank you very much. And there's a question here that came in from Dominic, and I just want to repeat for everyone, just so everyone knows that the webinar was recorded. Previous webinars have been recorded as well, and future webinars monthly will be. We already know that we have one towards the end of July scheduled with Dr. Linda Bluestein on joint hypermobility, and we'll have them scheduled monthly after that. So if you head to neilasher.com, www.neilasher.com, and you scroll all the way down, you'll see a list of quick links. Under the quick links, if you head to the webinar page, the webinar registration page, that you'll see where we present the recordings of these webinars. So visit the website, visit the webinar registration page, and you will see the webinars recordings. So everyone who joined this evening in some locations in the world and midday in North America, thank you very much for joining. Keep joining us. Keep checking in. We'll keep sending you updates. Paul Townley, thank you very much for your time and presentation.
Thank you.